great, whenever.
Okay, so we're happy to have Diego Rodriguez Gomez from the University of Oviedo giving us the first talk on excursions inside black holes of finite temperature CFTs.
Okay, so thank you very much. First of all, let me thank the organizers for putting together this conference and for having me talking. And second, I guess I should apologize a little bit because, well, we are celebrating Chan's anniversary, and I guess the level of math in my talk will not be too high. Still, I hope that there will be some physics which you might get out of it. All right, so so today I'll be talking about finite temperature CFTs, and basically what I will be talking about is based on these three papers which I wrote in collaboration with Jorge Russo from Barcelona and Hare Krishna from Stony Brook. All right, so let's start. Oops, why doesn't this go up like this? All right, so so let's start with something very basic as a warm up. So in the modern understanding of quantum field theory, the renormalization group plays a central role. It tells you how the relevant degrees of freedom to describe a system at a given scale change as you change that the scale at which you are probing the system. And this results in some trajectories which depart and end at so-called fixed points, where scale invariance and actually typically the whole conformal invariance emerges. So the endpoints of the RG flow are CFTs, and that makes CFTs, conformal field theories, very interesting. They also describe phase transitions and even systems in string theory like rings and so on. So that this class of theories, this class of quantum field theories, is very interesting to study. Now, CFTs, as they have conformal invariance, they have a structure. And to specify them, what you need to say is, the spectrum, that is a fancy name for the catalog of operators labeled by dimension and possibly other quantum numbers which the theory might have. The metric, which is encoded in the matrix of two-point functions of operators, and the structure constants of the operator algebra, which is encoded in three-point functions. And all these things have been studied a lot in the past from many different points of views. For instance, trying to impose consistency conditions to bound the possible structures which you may have, and many approaches to this to constraining what is a CFT and what properties CFTs have. And this is, well, let me be a little bit vague. Maybe you can call this the bootstrap program. Now, I think it's fair to say that implicitly most of this was for RD. Let's say you have a CFT in the dimensions. Maybe you want to big rotate the Euclidean, you put the theory on flat space, or perhaps it's conformally transformed Cassians like spheres or things like that. But another thing which we have learned rediscovered recently is that putting a theory in different manifolds may reveal new aspects, new things, or new relations between known things, which in RD, are obscure. And so motivated by this, the next two simplest manifold you may imagine is putting the theory on S1 times RD minus one. Just take one dimension of the RD and change it for a circle. But hey, that's equivalent to studying the theory at finite temperature. So this so simple background is very interesting. Well, you may have realized that the world is at finite temperature. So this is of obvious practical interest, but it's also theoretically interesting. And how is that? How is this blah, blah, blah realized? Well, in the case at hand, what happens is that this circle, this S1, buys you two things. On one hand, it buys you scale, the size of the circle, and on the other hand, it buys you spatial direction, that of the circle itself, that's this scaling, which allows primary operators to take a BEV. Descendants will still not take a BEV because translational invariance will still be a symmetry, and so descendants, which are derivatives, will not take a BEV, but primaries may take a BEV because since you have the spatial direction, you can soak up the tensor structure. And since you have a scale, the size of the circle, this beta, you can soak up the dimensions of the operator. And so generically, this B is just a number. Generically, the BEV of operators needs not to be zero. And this will get encoded in endpoint functions, which will have a much more interesting structure than in the RD flat space case. In particular, the two-point function, already the good old two-point function will have a much more interesting structure. And we will see explicitly how this comes about later on. Now, an interesting class of CFTs, among all possible CFTs you may imagine, an interesting quote-unquote class of CFTs are those which have a gravity dual. This idea of a CFT being dual to a gravitational theory in one dimension higher is something mind-blowing, which we have discovered over the last, let's say, 20 years or something like that. And it's a particular duality, but it's a mind-blowing duality. And there are lots of questions which you may ask. What is so special about these theories, about these CFTs? What's in their structure that they are able to reconstruct a geometry? Also, this is a strong coupling, strong weak coupling duality. So how can you use the gravitational side to study the non-perturbative physics of a CFT? And likewise, can you use a CFT to study things about quantum gravity? Lots of questions. And of course, this has been explored over the last years a lot. So motivated by this, today we're going to look to something very modest, namely the two-point thermal correlation function in holographic theories. We're going to concentrate on the sector of operators of large dimension, because that will be technically simpler. And it will be possible to, using the duality, see how the geometry knows about the structure of the CFT, how the expected structure of the two-point function emerges, and this will allow us to make some predictions or postdictions, because this was expected for other reasons in the literature, of scaling of the OPA coefficients, and even we will find a universal formula for the thermal free energy. Now, since you're going to be discussing theories which have a holographic dual, there is an extra twist into the story, which is that the gravity dual contains a black hole. We're going to study the theories at finite temperature, and so in the gravity dual, there is a black hole. So there is an obvious question, which is whether correlation functions can say anything about the black hole. Of course, this is a long-standing and not fulfilled dream of understanding what's inside of a black hole, horizons, and so on and so forth, using the gauge gravity correspondence, and the literature on this is huge. It's just two papers, but I mean, the list is huge, of course. So today we'll take a very modest step, and we will see how adding some corrections to the two-point functions, we will find a new way to probe the interior of black holes, which was, in addition to other possibilities which were discussed before. So to be more concrete, the contents of the talk are these ones here. So after this short motivation, I'll go on and discuss correlation. Well, how exactly do you compute correlation functions from holography? And then I'll apply this to the two-point function, simplest correlator, and we'll see how to compute correlators from holography, and we'll see how holography knows the structure of the CFT, and so on and so forth. And then I'll go on and include these corrections, which will allow us to probe the interior of black holes, and then we'll end up with a couple of comments. Of course, if you have any question, just interrupt me at any time. Oops. Okay, so let's start reviewing how do you compute correlators from holography. So we're going to be considering holographic CFTs, and that means that our CFTs, which will live in D dimensions, will be dual to some black hole in ABSD plus one, whose metric is this one here. This is the black plane metric, and this has a horizon small circle in this way. All right. The CFT will have a set of operators, and this translates through the standard dictionary into fluctuations living in this geometry. Each fluctuation will be dual to an operator. We're going to consider scalar operators, so we'll consider scalar fields living in this geometry. And each such field, the action is this one here. It has a mass, and the mass is related in the standard way to the dimension of the dual operator, through this usual formula. And in order to find correlation functions, what you have to do is, you basically have to solve the Klein-Gordon equation arising from this Lagrangian, with the relevant, with appropriate boundary conditions, of course, and then take some suitable limit, some limit like this, which allows you to extract the two-point function in the boundary theory, okay? Now, this is complicated because, with this metric, solving the Klein-Gordon equation to find G is complicated. But if delta is very large, then you can WKV approximate the equation of motion, the Klein-Gordon equation. And in the end, it turns out that this G, and hence basically the boundary propagator, happens to be just the geodesic distance, the exponential of the geodesic distance. This L is the geodesic distance between the two points in the boundary. before I make this a little bit more precise, just one comment. Delta much bigger than one means the mass much bigger than one, right? Because you see the dimension is going to be, you know, four or something like that. And so delta is basically, in this limit, delta is basically the mass. So that's why this is just a WKB approximation, because this is large mass. All right, so before making this a little bit more precise, just let me make a couple of comments. So in the end, the problem becomes just that of computing geodesics in black rain backgrounds. All right, so it's simple, some quote-unquote, not too complicated problem. Now, we're going to mostly consider the big rotation. So if you big rotate this metric, basically you make ti tau if you want, then the geometry becomes smoothly terminates at the horizon. And as we will see, the geodesics live in this geometry. There's space, like if you want. Euclidean doesn't make much sense to talk about other types of geodesics. And this will capture Euclidean thermal correlation functions. All right. And so just to make clear, we will be mostly considering the Euclidean thermal correlation functions. Now, let's better think of an example instead of being so generic, because this will make things a little bit clearer, I guess. Let's start with the simplest thing on Earth. Namely, let's look to the field theory at zero temperature, and let's compute the two-point function at t equals to zero in this large dimension limit. As I said, what you have to do is, you have to compute the geodesic, find a geodesic between two points in the boundary. This is this is like a Witten, quote unquote Witten diagram. This is the boundary of ADS if you want. And this is just a cartoon, okay? So this circle is like the boundary of ADS, and this is my geodesic, which joins the two points in the boundary where I am inserting the operators. And what I have to compute is, first of all, I have to find this geodesic, and then I need to compute its length, and then the exponential of the length is basically the two-point function of the boundary operators. Now it turns out that it's better to break this computation like in two halves or two bits like this. So break the geodesic into two parts and think of the two-point function as a kind of fake interacting Witten diagram. And so the boundary two-point function will be an integral over this point over the whole ADS. And then one propagator from here to there, which is the exponential of the length of the red geodesic, for instance, this one, and then this g, which the other propagator, which is the exponential of the geodesic length of the blue geodesic, if you want. So it boils down to compute. So the whole computation boils down to compute the action, the length e to the minus length, if you want, of a geodesic arc between a point in the boundary and a generic point in the bulk. And this is an easy problem. This is the most complicated math which I will have in my talk. So pretty easy. So let's just look to this bit over here, this one half of the problem, the relevant half of the problem. So just took the red segment, the red geodesic. So the action, geodesic is the same as the action of a, I mean, the geodesic length is the same as the action for a particle from here to there. So this is my action. And there is a conserved momentum because, here I'm using the C coordinate in ADS as time. And so since this doesn't depend on, I mean, X doesn't appear, only appears X dot, there is the momentum is conserved. So I can find a first order equation of motion, which is this one here. And plugging this back into the action, I can integrate and find the action for the corresponding geodesic. Now, this is not really what I want. What I want is to find not the action as a function of the momentum or whatever, but the action as a function of the boundary points of the geodesic, this point and this point. But this is easy to do in this case. I just take this equation, which is the equation for the trajectory. I evaluate at this point, I invert for p, and then plug it back here. And then I find the action, which is the length of this geodesic as a function of this point and this point. So x, which is this point, enters here. Well, this is the x and the c coordinates, and x1 is about this boundary point. And then there is some epsilon regulator standard story for the boundary. This doesn't have anything new. And so now this integral is explicitly this integral over here. There is a new thing, there's an extra thing which the geodesic approximation buys for us, which is that since delta is very large, you can do this integral in the saddle point approximation, and after the dash settles, you just find the saddle point of this, plug it in back, standard story, you find that the two-point function is, well, just the expected thing. All right, so this is how it works. Very simple. Now, so we would like to do the same thing, but at finite temperature. First of all, let's go back to the discussion in the introduction and see how the circle gives us more structure into the two-point function. So to begin with, let's look to the OPE. So let's take one operator inserted at zero, well, at some point, and some other operator inserted at some finite distance x. This is the flat space, standard flat space OPE. And well, you have this thing over here. Here I'm omitting descendants because they will not take a bev. They will have vanishing bev. So as you will see in a moment, it's safe to omit them. But this is just the standard OPE in flat space. This thing here, this FOO, is just the structure constant, the OPE coefficient. This C, just an, well, it's just because I'm not normalizing. Well, not necessary. It's not necessarily true that the operators have unit normalized two-point functions. So this C is just the coefficient of the two-point function of the operators. And well, this just follows from dimensional analysis and well, you have to soak up the indices. So this is kind of straightforward. So as we said, the crucial point is that the geometry provides both a spatial direction and a scale. And so these guys can take a bev. And the bev has to be something like this. All right. There is just, well, the tensor structure is soaked up by the only tensor structure which you can construct with the killing direction which you have. The beta soaks up the dimensions. And B is just a coefficient, a pure number. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this and just take bevs of this equation. And if you take the bev of this, take the bev of this equation, since at non-zero temperature, this case can take a bev, now you get something more complicated. When the dust settles, what you get is that the two-point function has this structure over here. All right, so it's a sum where all possible operators appearing in the OOPE, this calligraphic O is all possible operators which can appear in this OPE, they manifest themselves in the two-point function. Of course, at zero temperature, since the bevs are zero, the only term in this sum is the identity, the contribution of the identity. And this recovers the standard thing, I mean, the standard two-point function for operators at zero temperature. But at non-zero temperature, because of having this thing, the two-point function can have a much more complicated structure. These things, these C's are Gegenbauer polynomials, and it's good to introduce these quantities. X is basically the median distance, and eta is, well, it's just this this coefficient. And these A's are just some numbers. Okay, there is some coefficients, some numerical coefficient. Basically, these A's are coefficients which take into account the structure constants of the OPE, the BEVs, and the two-point functions. All right. And there's one important thing. This J, to remember, this J is the spin of the corresponding operator which appears in the two-point function. The contribution, the operator which is contributing, well, if it has a spin J, it gives you the Gegenbauer polynomial J. Okay. Now, this is all very nice, but you may have wondered that this is, wait a moment, this is at finite temperature, or in other words, we have a circle. So there is something to say, there's a warning to say in this, to add to this formula, because the cartoon is really something like this. There is a circle, and we're inserting one operator here, the other operator there, and we are using the OPE in this ball, if you want. Of course, it's obvious from this cartoon that this ball cannot be larger than the size of the circle. Because if it is larger than the size of the circle, it will start winding on the other side of the circle, if you want, and therefore the formula, well, ceases to make sense. So this formula is valid provided the distance between the insertions is smaller. I don't know, we shouldn't have written much more. It's just smaller than beta. All right, so this is to be remembered. This formula is valid for this x being smaller than beta, the size of the thermal circle. So So now let's go to holography and let's compute holographically these two-point functions. We have to do exactly the same thing as we did before, but for the black hole. The only complicated thing is to find, let me go back. We have to repeat this slide, but in the black hole case, the only complicated thing will be really to do this saddle point integral, which basically amounts to find, in the end of the day, where is the turning point of the U, because the geodesic in the end will be like a U. So where is the saddle point of this is just the turning point of this U, the lowest point of the U. And if you do the math, I'm not going to bore you with all those things, it turns out that the turning point of the U, this mu is just some rescaling of the same momenta which I had before, happens to be this. If you choose the plus branch, this is between 0 and 1, and this means that this is in the Euclidean part of the geometry. So everything happens in the Euclidean part of the geometry, in the cigar. And after the dust settles, it turns out that the equivalent, let me go back, the equivalent to this formula which I had here, well, to the exponential of this formula better, is now this. So it's this in terms of the mu, and mu is related to the, here, by the way, I'm considering only time-dependent correlators, so equal x insertions. So mu is related to this, to the time difference of the insertions in this way. All right. Of course, ideally, just as we did at zero temperature, we would invert this formula to find mu as a function of tau, plug it in here, and then problem solved. Here you go. The correlator is whatever. But you see, now what happens is that this is a transcendental equation. You cannot invert mu as a function of tau. So you have to live with this implicitly defined correlator. All right. And this is the source slash the cause, the source and, well, cause and consequence of all the subtleties and interesting things which finite temperature gives. There is one interesting comment, which is if you look to this thing over here, this is like this is just a modulus one number. So this means that because of the branch of the multivaluedness of the logarithm, this tau is defined only up to 2π/4, so pi over two shifts. And this, if you restore the factors of temperature, this is just the familiar KMS, Kubo-Martin-Schwinger periodicity, which the correlator might have, and this must have. And this is nothing but remembering that in the Euclidean, well, you have a circle. I mean, the time is a circle, so this T has to be periodic. Okay, so this is how KMS appears. So as I said before, now what you would do is you would invert this formula, find mu as a function of tau, plug it in there, and problem solved. Unfortunately, this is not possible. So the next to best that you can do is, suppose you want to compute the correlator for some difference of times, I don't know, two imaginary seconds or something. So you put two here, say you use fine routing mathematica to solve for mu, maybe there will be more than one solution, and perhaps that might happen. And then, if so, you have to choose the mu given the largest contribution, plug it in the formula for the correlator, and that's the value of the two-point function. All right. Fortunately, in the regime of small x, the dominant contribution comes from large mu. So you can solve in perturbation theory for large mu, which is small tau. You can solve that equation perturbatively, and you find this. So this can be plugged, this can be inverted also perturbatively, and plugged back in the equation for the correlator, and what you find is, well, this more or less complicated result. So this is the two-point function in d equals to 4 in particular, right? You can do this in the dimensions, and what you find here, I'm quoting only the leading term, what you find is this with some particular number, some particular coefficient, which is, well, not too illuminating, this thing here. What is more interesting is that if you recover the x dependence, do exactly the same exercise, but recovering the full x dependence of the correlator, what you find is that, well, here plus dot dot dots, is what you find is this. So you recover the expected Gegenbauer polynomial, the expected expansion in Gegenbauer polynomials. So nicely, gravity knows, well, this is probably a symmetry thing, but gravity knows that the two-point function has to admit an expansion in Gegenbauer polynomials. If you take this formula and, for instance, you particularize it to d equals to 4, you expand the exponential and rewrite the powers of the Gegenbauer polynomials themselves in Gegenbauer polynomials, what you find is, this. So here you can identify the contribution of all spins from 0 to 2n of a dimension 4n, actually, operator. And so this suggests that what happens is that all these terms, they correspond to the, this means that what you have is that all these terms correspond to the contributions of the nth powers of the energy momentum tensors. Of course, if you do the nth power, there are you can do many contractions with spin 0, 2, 4, blah, blah, depending on how you contract the indices up to 2n. So these are all the contributions. And the numbers are these ones over here. This is perhaps, I mean, the most interesting thing of these numbers is not, okay, these coefficients, which you can compute explicitly, they are okay, given by Gegenbauer polynomials by themselves. This is curiosity. The interesting thing of this, or one interesting thing of this, is that you see, this gives you a delta to the n. More generically, this would give you a delta, if you do this not in four dimensions, but in any other dimension, here you will have this scaling with delta, the delta of the fields here, raised to the power of the dimension of the operator which has been exchanged in the OPE, namely this nth power of the stress energy tensor divided over d. And this is precisely the expected scaling which you can argue for using, in particular, the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. So this nicely recovers the expectations. Now, the first step, so since these guys correspond to the to powers of the stress energy tensor, the first such guy, the first contribution here corresponds to the stress energy tensor itself. So you can find a formula for the free energy as a function of the central charge. And well, when you do the math and so on, when everything settles down, this is what you find. And this can be checked using the strong coupling free energy from the classic Gapser-Klebanoff-Zeilin paper. For instance, to compute the central charge for n equals to 4, ABGM, and the 2.0 theory, just plug the free energy there and compute for C, you find these numbers, which are precisely, well, in this convention, precisely the correct central charges. And it's interesting to say that in this, in order to get to this formula, one has to use a number of ingredients, not only all this holographic computation, but also a very precise normalization for the world identity, for the superconformal world identity. And so this, the fact that you get the correct numbers touches upon delicate equilibrium between many different things. So it's a nice check of the results. Now, so far we have been looking to the, let's say, leading term of the two-point function, where in the bulk we consider only the free field the free field action. Of course, this should be just the leading contribution to the two-point function. In general, there would be corrections to that coming from two sources, if you want. On one hand, there will be terms higher order in the fluctuations. Ideally, what you would do is to expand the type 2B Lagrangian around the black hole, let's say ADS5, the black hole in ADS5 times S5, and then you expand the type 2B action around this, and then you will get, in general, well, the free field action plus terms cubic in the fluctuations plus terms quartic in the fluctuations and so on and so forth. So there will be terms higher order in the fluctuations, but there will also be, in principle, higher curvature corrections to the type 2B Lagrangian. And this results both in new couplings for the fluctuations and in a corrected background. Of course, doing this in a bottom-up, sorry, in a top-down construction is very complicated. So let's look to a toy model which has these features. So the kind of Lagrangian which we'll be considering is something like this. So we may have, so let's forget about these terms for a second. So we may have fields which are charged under some global symmetry. That's when I have them, they are complex. Some other fields which may be neutral, their corresponding masses, which dictate the corresponding, the dimension of the corresponding operator. And then, well, there will be the terms higher order in the fluctuations, which will be cubic, and so on and so forth. And then there will be higher curvature corrections, which will be, well, for this, neutral fields, there will be the neutral field times up times divided tensor squared. While for the charge fields, they will start with the phi squared, well, absolute value phi squared, square of the W of the by tensor, and so on and so forth. All right, so this is the higher curvature couplings to two gravitons, and these are the cubic couplings, which will give rise to three-point functions. Of course, the precise details, whether these are this, what's the value of these numbers, and the precise structure of the couplings will depend on the particular compactification. But this will enter only in who are these numbers, these coupling constants, and this will be just an overall factor in our computations. So, what do these terms buy for us? Well, what they buy for us is that now we have an expansion of the two-point function in Witten diagrams. Before, we just had this guy. And if we look to neutral operators, we would have a term like this, where we have an insertion. We will have an insertion of the cubic coupling, and then the W squared term. And if you have the charged, if you have charged fields in addition to this diagram, you would have a diagram mediated by this guy, like this. All right, plus higher order corrections, plus more terms higher in the vertices. All right. And in principle, all this is to be evaluated in the higher curvature corrected background. Of course, since we're going to work to leading order, such higher curvature correction to the background will only affect this guy here, and these diagrams will be computed with the uncorrected background. So let's look to the change of this diagram. By when you include higher curvature corrections, let's do this in equals to 4. The background is known, Gabser, Klebanov, and Seiling in 98 computed the background. And well, it's pretty simple to realize that these results, at least to leading order, these results in just a change of the numbers is the same functional form which I said before, but only a change of the numbers. And in particular, if you follow the numbers, the particular change of the numbers, for instance, for the free energy is this one here, which exactly coincides with the expectation from Gabser, Klebanov, and Seiling. The subleading diagrams are more interesting. Let's start by the neutral operators. So for neutral operators, the leading diagram, the first diagram correcting the leading term, the subleading term, if you want, is this one here. Here's another cartoon of the same diagram. Here I depicted the black hole, if you want. So how do you compute this? Well, now we have two vertices which we have to integrate over the whole bulk, and we have one propagator from here to there, the other propagator from here to there, and then a propagator from the black to the from the blue to the red vertex, something like this, and then the insertion of the W squared term. Now, before doing any computation, the interesting thing is that the interesting observation is that the Weyl tensor is biggest close to the singularity. So this means that if you want, using the geodesic approximation intuition, this guy here will pull from this vertical geodesic down very close to the singularity. And so this vertical geodesic will want to explore close to the singularity. If you do the computation, it turns out that this can be rewritten in a nicer way, like this. So this can be, well, a factor of the bev of the operator can be factored out. How do you compute the bev of the operator? Well, it's just this diagram. So you can factor out this diagram, and then you can leave this computation, which you can argue it lives only in the cigar geometry. All right, so this is a more or less complicated computation, which lives only in the cigar geometry. However, this bit here, which one can extract, which corresponds to the bev of the operator, is the bit which explores inside of the geometry. This guy here does need the inside of the inner part of the geometry, if you want. And this is the diagram which was explored recently by Greenberg and Maldacena to argue that this is a proof of the singularity, because this tells you, I mean, this diagram ends up being proportional basically to the time of travel to the singularity. All right, so this is a proof of the, as argued by this gentleman, this is a proof of the singularity. And there is another interesting observation, which is that this integral needs not to vanish if I and j are different. So this is a very complicated way of saying that because of the, that this diagram can mediate off-diagonal correlation functions between operators of different dimension. And these not and those off-diagonal correlators, for them, since the leading term is zero, this would be, I mean, the leading term. This diagram just vanishes for them, for these off-diagonal correlators. This diagram here would be the leading guy, and it would be proportional to the, and it is proportional to the bev of the exchanged operator. And so they are direct probes of the singularity. Well, this integral here can be done. Let me just give you an example. If you do the integral and you expand the corresponding exponential and so on, you nicely recover the announced expansion in Gegenbauer polynomials. This CD is just a number. I didn't bother to write it down because it's just a number, complicated number, which now doesn't say too much. But it can be made completely precise. Interesting thing is that you recover the expected expansion in Gegenbauer polynomials, the expected form with the bev of the operator and the coefficient of the three-point function. And this is all proportional. The subleading term is proportional to the bev of the operator, which does prove the inner part of the singularity. There is another interesting thing. This formula is, or better, the analysis which we have been doing is for insertions. Well, it was implicitly for insertions very close one to the other in the OPE regime, if you want. What if you want to explore the full thermal circle? It turns out that, and this is a cartoon of what's going on. So if you separate the operators, let's say not too much, you have a configuration which would look something like this would be my cigar, if you want. And well, you would have one geodesic, the other geodesic meeting in the triple intersection and then going all the way to the bottom of the geometry, where it would meet the rest of the geometry going all the way to the singularity. As you start separating these points, this bottom of the U, quote unquote, starts going down. And interestingly, before, and this is important, before the two points are diametrically separated in the circle, the lowest point hits the horizon. If you are looking to the vanilla configuration, the lowest point hits the horizon right when they are diametrically separated. Well, this is kind of clear by symmetry, and here it happens before. So what happens from there on? Well, what happens from there on is that there is a configuration which has kind of a wedge, this cartoon, these yellow lines, which are two straight geodesics which meet at the bottom. This has a wedge, but it's not a problem because it's an interacting Witten diagram, no problem with having a wedge, which describes the correlator from here to there. So there is sort of a phase transition, if you want, in the correlator, in the description of the correlator. However, most probably this phase transition is just an artifact of the geodesic approximation, if you want, of the large of the semi-classical limit, which is the geodesic approximation. Because if you were to compute the Klein-Gordon equation, probably this transition would be smoothed out, and it would be sort of a crossover, something which would be interesting to explore. Okay, so for charge operators, in addition to the previous diagram, you would have also this other diagram, which is interesting in its own way. If you evaluate it, it contains now two propagators and then the emission of two gravitons, the W square over here. And so when you do the, computing these two propagators is very simple, and the complicated, quote-unquote, complicated thing is to find, to do this integral using the saddle point approximation. And it turns out that now there are three saddles, two of them complex and complex conjugated one of the other. If you look to configurations which are widely separated on the circle, these are dominating configurations. They contribute equally, actually, and these are the dominating configurations. And you have to add them up. And when you add them up, each one better contributes something like this. Here there is the Greenberg-Maldacena factor of the time travel to the singularity, actually twice, because you have to go back and forth if you want. You have two geodesics, and then you have this cos blah contribution. And it's very interesting that you can massage this contribution, you can write it in this way, and you see emerging the quasi-normal modes of the black hole. Well, they are sort of encoded in here. So it's interesting that this diagram not only allows us to explore the singularity, you can see the Greenberg-Maldacena signature of time travel to the singularity, but also the quasi-normal frequencies, because in the end you are exciting the black hole, if you want, and so the black hole wants to vibrate at the frequencies of the quasi-normal modes. And since time is running out, let me just end up with a couple of summary. We have explored the two-point thermal correlation functions in CFTs in the Euclidean. They nicely fit the expected expectations from the bootstrap, and interestingly, at the leading order, they are governed by powers. I mean, the correlator is governed by powers of the energy momentum tensor. The coefficients precisely reproduce the expectations, and if you including higher curvature corrections, we can see how the BEVs of operators, of neutral operators, start manifesting themselves exactly in the expected form from the bootstrap. And also, these BEVs allow us to probe the interior of the black hole, in particular in the, allow us to probe the interior of the black hole. And, well, I guess I'm running late, so. Many thanks for the attention.
So thanks, Diego, for a very nice talk. Are there any questions?
I have a question, Diego. This is George Minich. So it's a nice talk. I have a question about the Lorentzian versus Euclidean. In principle, the settle point, right, will be different in the Lorentzian and the Euclidean signature. And how does this enter here? And in particular, if you try to address singularity, right? If you really want to talk about the singularity, right? You want to talk about the causal structure, etc. So presumably you want to be Lorentzian, right?
Well, you see, let's discuss first, let's go back to our expansion and Witten diagrams. Let's discuss this guy first. Yeah, it's true. Discuss the structure. If you want to see the singularity, if you want, you really want to be Lorentzian, as you say. And then what happens is that the geodesics. So if you studied geodesics in Lorentzian signature, they can only go. I mean, they will. This cartoon is not correct in the Lorentzian, because a geodesic cannot explore inside the horizon and then come back. It has to go to the other boundary, end of the singularity, or go to the other boundary in the eternal black hole. So you will be describing a geodesic which sort of goes from one boundary to the other boundary and passes very close to the singularity. All right, and this is what was studied by Schenker, Houveni, and friends, and many other people, and it turns out that there are some, I would say, subtle signatures of the singularity in that, of the singularity of the black hole, I mean, in that if you do the appropriate continuation of time to some complex values, whatever, I won't enter in the technicalities, you will see that the correlator will exhibit some singularity which stands for the singularity of the black hole. There are many ways, many words, many singularity words here, and we're making things complicated. But
Can I tell you what my conceptual issue always is from the string theory point of view? Because ultimately, we have a string in this background, right? Yeah, we can do the semi-classical gravity computation, but we all know that we have a string. The string is defined by some conformal field theory, which has some RR charges. It's very complicated. Our friends who are solving N equals 4 are dealing with this and so forth. And presumably, it's even more complicated in this case. And in particular, you see that CFT somehow has to capture the time-dependent nature of the world inside, and especially when you get to the singularity. Now, we know the time-dependent CFTs are very tricky. I mean, you know, John, and he knows this, of various people. I mean, you know, if you just put the CFT on the orbifold, time orbifold, you have issues, and not to mention something general. You know, there will be basically operators that contains time derivatives, which high, you know, infinite order in power.
Yeah.
Okay. And therefore it looks non-unitary, all sorts of problems. That's why we have issues with the sitter cosmology, etc. So I would imagine that this has to hit us at some point. And I always wondered in any of these papers, Shankar et al., where is this buried? Because obviously you don't see it, right? You're not doing string theory. You're doing this kind of gravity computation. But it has to be buried somewhere, because we know the string is propagating, really. And there's a CFT in this background.
Well, it's a hard question. I don't think I know. I can say, what is the problem hiding in Shankar's computation? Maybe you want to ask Shankar for that. But that's why I said, I'm going to build Euclidean. And in the Euclidean, this diagram lives completely in the cigar geometry, and there is no problem with that. So you see, you could do the following very simple-minded thing, which is, let's say, if you take Federer and Baleka, it would tell you to compute the Euclidean correlator and then big rotate. So imagine I was smart enough just to compute the Euclidean correlator, and then when I have T, I put IT. That's it. Then I would be fine. Of course, you could say.
Yeah, but that's flat space time. Federer, Valechka, that's flat space time.
Well, no, it's finite temperature, right?
Yeah, I know. But it's, I think, different, right, when you have a curved space time and finite temperature.
The holographic recipe would be that, if I suppose I'm able to do the following computation. Suppose I take this. In principle, exactly. Well, this is exactly the formula in Schenker and friends. It's not complicated to get. This completely describes the correlator. Suppose you were smart enough so as to invert this formula. Then you plug it in there. You have the correlator, and you can forget where it came from. You can put whatever you have, tau. You can put back IT, and that's it. This actually works if you do in three dimensions. In three dimensions, it turns out that the equivalent to this can be, well, it's much, much simpler. We can discuss why is it, maybe because the Penrose diagram. Okay, let's not enter in this discussion, but in three dimensions, this works like this. You can, the equivalent to this right-hand side of the equation is much simpler, quote unquote. You can invert this equation, plug it in there, and find a correlator. And if you now take where you have T, you put IT, then you get exactly the correct result. And I say exactly the correct result because in two-dimensional CFTs, the thermal correlator in flat space, I mean, the R times S1 correlator follows from conformal invariance, right? There is a Cardi paper which shows this. So what I'm saying is that if you were smart enough just to take this equation and invert it and put it in there, then you would have the correlator, forget where it comes from, put T, well, tau IT, and that's it. Unfortunately, you cannot do that. Maybe there, that's where what you're saying hides. In the fact that you have to live with this equation, which has multivaluedness and many complicated things. In this, there will be more than one solution thing. I think there is a lot hiding.
So maybe you have to do some Picard-Lefschetz type of thing. Okay. Well, anyway, that was a good comment. Thank you. That was illuminating. Thanks.
Any other questions for Diego?
Yeah. I just have a quick question. Thank you, Diego, for that lovely talk. Just a quick question: are your alpha d's and a d's necessarily volumes of d manifolds?
Which alpha?
In your just, I think the next slide.
Maybe this one.
In your correlation, yeah. They smell as there should be volumes of D manifolds of certain type.
I have no idea. They are complicated.
You know, it looks like, you know, it's SD, but of course, massage. I like this massage. It would be interesting to reverse engineer a D manifold whose volume is that.
That would be, well, maybe there is something to it, because surely if you look to the first guy, what's the first guy is the, I mean, the first, by first guy, I mean the first term in the expansion of this, the first, if you expand this exponential, the first alpha, it's basically the free energy. And the free energy has to do with the central charge, which has to do with the volume of something. So maybe there is something to it. That would be awesome.
That'd be cool.
In fact, well, okay, yeah, I won't say
that. Yeah, we'll do this over beer at some point.
You can write, there is a very nice way of writing this as an integral, which sort of looks like a, I'm not going to enter into this because I don't know what to say other than the observation is that if you use the properties of the Gegenbauer, curiously enough, in four dimensions, you can write the coefficient can be written in terms of Gegenbauer polynomials itself. Is this a coincidence? Well, I have no idea, but you can, using the properties of the polynomials, you can write this in terms of some sort of matrix integral. Whether that's a coincidence, I mean, I have no idea, but maybe there's something interesting behind that. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, so thank you, Diego, for a wonderful talk. And the next speaker is Juan Simone. So maybe Juan can pull up.